Listening to the planet, WBCQ, from Monticello, Maine, in the United States of America. It's free speech radio.
Tonight you're going to hear a headline which originally aired over 4 years ago, so don't pay any attention to any addresses, phone numbers, commercials, anything like that. But please pay very close attention to the meat of tonight's broadcast, because I think it's very important that you all understand how much of their lives the founders gave so that we might, if we were smart enough and watchful enough and brave enough, live in freedom. We being their posterity. And of course, that means our posterity. Forever. But pay very close attention, folks, because I'm going to tell you right now, they risked everything. And many of them lost everything. And the reason we're doing it all on is I'm still working on computers.
Okay.
Would you start us off there, please?
Yes. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with perfect and justice for all.
Thank you very much.
Honey?
Yes.
I would like to say it again.
You want to say it again?
Yes.
Well, go ahead.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Well, thank you. We got a double whammy tonight.
From the mountain, through the mountain, through the ocean, wide with wind, God has the blessing, the free
Declaration of Independence, ladies and gentlemen, is something that is not taught anymore. I hope your children are sitting in your living room listening to this broadcast, because tonight we're going to hear a little about it. You're going to hear about the enduring truth of its first before freedom, the underlying courage of sacrifice required of its tyrants. John Adams said in 1781, and I quote, "This immortal declaration of the 4th of July, 1776, was not the effect of any sudden passion or enthusiasm, but a matter which had been long in deliberation among the people, maturely discussed in some hundreds of popular assemblies and by public writings of all the states. It was a measure which Congress, the Continental Congress, did not adopt until they had received the positive instructions of their constituents in all the states. It was then unanimously adopted by Congress, subscribed by all its members, transmitted to the assemblies of the several states, and by them respectively accepted, ratified, and recorded among their archives, so that no decree, edict, statute, placard, or fundamental law of any nation was ever made with more solemnity or with more unanimity or cordiality adopted as the act and consent of the whole people than this. And it has been held sacred to this day by every state with such unshaken firmness that not even the smallest has ever been induced to depart from it, although the English have wasted many millions and vast fleets and armies in the vain attempt to invalidate it." End quote. The Pennsylvania State House, ladies and gentlemen, was hot. It was humid. And it was charged with emotion as representatives from the 13 colonies came together in June and July of 1776 to consider severing their allegiance to an oppressive government and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitled them. Every single man felt the enormous significance of the moment. On a June 9th, 1776 letter, John Adams confirmed, I quote, "Objects of the most stupendous magnitude and measures in which the lives and liberties of millions yet unborn are intimately interested are now before us. When these things are once completed, I shall think that I have answered the end of my creation," end quote. And each man knew the dangers he faced. Already, two revolutionary leaders, John Hancock and Samuel Adams, faced the scaffold if caught by the British. For to England, these men were traitors. All knew that if their mission failed, they too would be hanged for treason. And as John Adams noted in a letter to Abigail, the declaration was, in fact, an act of treason. And if it were not made good, those who had signed it stood a good chance to incur the penalty meted out to traitors. But the signers of the Declaration of Independence were not, ladies and gentlemen, rabble-rousers. They were, as patriots are today, responsible leaders . These men were from the 13 colonies, men of vision, of high standing in their communities. 25 were lawyers or jurists. 11 were merchants. 9 were farmers or large plantation owners, and were also doctors and educators. You see, a war was already in progress as they gathered in the Pennsylvania State House in a sweltering, hot, humid room, with doors and windows tightly shut, and pledged their lives, their fortunes, and risked conviction for treason in order to gain liberty for themselves and you, their posterity. They formed a committee on June 11th to draw up a declaration. The members of this committee were John Adams, Benjamin Franklin, Thomas Jefferson, Roger Sherman, and Robert Livingston. Jefferson, whose writing skills were acknowledged by the other committee members, was chosen to draft the declaration. Looking back on the event in 1825, Jefferson recalled that their purpose had been to provide an appeal to the tribunal of the world. This, he said, was the object of the Declaration of Independence, not to find out new principles or new arguments, not merely to say things which had never been said before, but to place before mankind the common sense of the subject in terms so plain and as to command their assent and to justify ourselves in the independent stand we are compelled to take. In other words, he explained, it was intended to be an expression of the American mind. All its authority rests then on the harmonizing sentiments of the day, expressed in conversation, in letters, printed essays, and in the books of public right, such as Aristotle, Cicero, Locke, Sidney, et al. Now, on July 3rd, the declaration was almost ready. Jefferson, you see, had completed a second draft, and only a few minor alterations were needed. Decisions on the final wording was near. One delegate, only one, Caesar Rodney, who had gone back to Delaware on an important errand, was summoned for the vote. Suffering from an advanced case of facial cancer, he nevertheless rode horseback all night long in the rain, arriving late in the morning for this crucial decision, which no one would vote upon in his absence. There was much heated debate, because not everyone was convinced that the time had come for a formal severance of all ties with the mother country. John Dickinson spoke eloquently, persuasively, of the need for restraint, warning of the calamities that might follow should they fail. The delegates, or at least some of them, were wavering. From Edward Rutledge, who called upon John Adams to speak out in support of independence. This was a crucial moment. Adams rose to the occasion. He made an impassioned appeal to reason that restored the resolve of the representatives to risk everything that they possessed in support of independence. Making no false claims, Adams spoke with candor and told the monarch, if you imagine that I expect this declaration will ward off calamities, you, sir, are mistaken. A bloody conflict we are destined to endure. The mission, Adams says, was accomplished. And what was to become the greatest nation in the history of the world came into being. The spirit of liberty, which had taken root on American soil more than 150 years earlier and had flourished in the American mind, had now expressed itself to the entire world. Adopted on July 4, 1776, the Declaration of Independence became the fundamental statement of the basic principles and timeless truths upon which the nation was to be established and was in fact the first document in law. 11 years later, the framers of the Constitution of the United States of America ruled by that document, establishing a new government upon the principles set forth in the Declaration. By so doing, they would translate the philosophy of the Declaration into a constitutional structuring of a government of limited powers based upon the consent of the governed, designed to secure the individual's creator endowed rights of life, liberty, property, and the pursuit of happiness. when the Declaration was signed,
William Ellery
of Rhode Island
stood where he could watch each man affix his signature.
I was determined,
he wrote,
to see how they all looked as they signed what might be their death warrant. I eyed each closely. Undaunted resolution was displayed upon every countenance.
Such, ladies and gentlemen, was the strength and courage of our founding fathers.
No one today remembers all of that. It's not taught anymore. Very few understand or realize the hardships that the men who signed that document faced and indeed underwent after the act itself was performed. These were indeed brave men who were loyal to principles and ideals and accomplished what no humanity had ever accomplished before in the history of this earth. For the first time, each and every man stood as a sovereign king in his own right, with the government as his chattel servant. Each and every person, it was recognized, was endowed by their creator with certain unalienable, natural, irrevocable rights, protected by the first document in law, the Declaration of Independence, and then later the Articles of Confederation, and finally, the ultimate of their genius, the Constitution for the United States of America, and the first 10 amendments, which we know today, for those of us who know it, the Bill of Rights. And the price that they paid, these men, gave us all that we have or ever will have or have ever known, was staggering. Posterity, you will never know how much it costs the present generation to preserve your freedom. I hope you will make good use of it, said John Quincy Adams. Posterity, ladies and gentlemen, is them. You are their posterity. John Quincy Adams, the son of a revolutionary leader, knew firsthand about the hardships of the men who signed the Declaration of Independence. Future generations have also come, those of us who have studied it, to appreciate the great personal sacrifices they made to win freedom for themselves, their families, their countrymen, and you, their posterity. You, the sheeple, who in the process of giving it away. It is little wonder, therefore, that Americans have traditionally revered the extraordinary men who gave us not only independence, but also the greatest system of government ever known to man, ever. To the American people, at least until the present day, they were known affectionately as the founding fathers. Today, they would be called right-wing religious fundamentalists, militia member terrorists, by those who enjoy the freedom, the fruits, the benefits, the results of all that they suffered. And I'm going to tell you now the accounts of their suffering, each of them. Listen carefully, for they gave up all, everything, so that you can whine and complain and stick out your hand with little children to the government to protect you, while you scream about patriots and militiamen who are out to get you, whose only interest is in the preservation of what our founding fathers created and gave to us. For these men and women,
of the modern day, to follow in the footsteps of those who created this great nation, understand that to give it up is to give up the ultimate achievement of all humankind and revert back to the position of slavery. In early September, in 1776, the British burned the home of Francis Lewis, and they seized his wife. Out of the prison with no bed and no change of clothes, she was finally released after 2 years of suffering. Her health was gone, and she died soon after her release. Lewis, though heartbroken, continued to serve in the Continental Congress until 1779. He died in 1802. At the age of 89. I've heard everything for you, and you never heard of him until tonight. Philip Livingston's 150,000-acre estate was seized by the British, but he continued to contribute his dwindling fortune to Congress for the war effort. He financed the beginning of this nation. The strain of the revolutionary struggle also depleted his health, and he died less than 2 years after he signed the Declaration of Independence. How many of you ever heard of Philip Livingston? Or Lewis Morris, whose Westchester estate was ransacked by the British, and nearly 1,000 acres were burned, his home was destroyed, his cattle butchered, and his family driven from home. Morris also served in the New York Senate and died in 1798 at the age of 71. John Hart's New Jersey home was looted and burned, his grist mills destroyed, while he eluded capture by sleeping in caves and forests. His ailing wife died and his 13 children were scattered. His failing health forced him to leave the New Jersey legislature in 1779, and he died less than 3 years after the declaration was signed. Joseph Hughes of though at first reluctant to favor independence, gave tirelessly of himself to create a navy and help General Washington. He worked long hours without adequate food. He lost his health and died in 1779 at the age of 49. Richard Stockton rushed home to Princeton, New Jersey in 1776 to rescue his family from approaching British troops. He was captured and thrown into prison, where he was repeatedly beaten and kept near starvation. The British also destroyed his home and burned his papers. And as a result of his mistreatment, he became an invalid and died in 1781. William Floyd's estate in New York was overrun and ruined by the British. Although he could not return to his home during the 7 years of the war, he gallantly served his country in the New York Senate and as a representative from New York in the first Congress, and then he died in 1821. Thomas Hopkinson's home was twice ransacked. But his enthusiasm for the war effort never wavered, and he remained in Congress for the Revolution. His artistic sketch of the Stars and Stripes led to our official United States flag. But the years, ladies and gentlemen, had taken their toll, and he died suddenly in 1791 at the age of 53. Abraham Clark also served in Congress throughout the war. He had two sons in the Continental Army. That's a fancy name for militia. Both of whom received harsh treatment from the British after they were captured. Clark continued to serve his country in many ways, and he was elected a delegate to the Federal Convention of 1787 that produced our Constitution. He died at 68. Caesar Rodney, the one upon whom they waited while he rode through the night, became a major general in the Delaware militia. Militia. If you're a puke-faced communist, liberal, thug, Marxist scumbag, I hope that word makes you sick. Militia. became a major general in the Delaware militia. And despite his advancing facial skin cancer, fought beside his men in the bitter winter of 1776. In 1777, he also served in the Delaware legislature and was appointed to the Congress in 1782. Declining health kept him from serving, however. He died in 1784, at the young age of 55. Thomas McKean recalled to John Adams that he was hunted like a fox during the Revolution, and at one time was compelled to maul his family 5 times in just a few months. He served faithfully, however, signing the Articles of Confederation, serving as President of Congress, Chief Justice of Pennsylvania, and as a delegate to the Constitutional Convention, and finally as Governor of Pennsylvania. Fox Connor's home in Chester was taken over by the British. Although he lost more than 100 of his ships during the Revolution, he dedicated himself to raising money for the war effort, working closely with his friend, Robert Morris. And in 1781, Robert Morris issued over $1 million of personal credit to finance the war effort and raised $200,000 from friends to defeat the British at Yorktown. 1798, his personal finance collapsed, never reimbursed by his country. He spent 3 years in a debtor's prison. Scratched on his poor health, he died in 1806. Many of you have even given $5, or $20, or $100 to help us sow what these men gave their all to give to us. John Morton was criticized bitterly by many of his Pennsylvania neighbors for breaking the tie vote of the Pennsylvania delegation in favor of independence. The criticism depressed him deeply. Early in 1777, he became ill and died. Among his last words were these, and I quote, "Tell them that they shall acknowledge it to have been the most glorious service that I have ever rendered to my country," end quote. William Hoffa of Maryland poured thousands of dollars of his own personal fortune into clothing the American soldiers. He worked to establish Maryland's government and served as governor from 1782 to 1785. William Ellery's Newport home was burned during the invasion of Rhode Island. He nevertheless continued to serve his country. William sacrificed his fortune for the cause, financing a number of enterprises in the Ticonderoga offensive. Carter Braxton saw virtually every merchant ship he owned sunk or captured by the British. And although he lost his wealth and was forced to sell his land, continued to serve in the Virginia legislature. Lyman Hall's rice plantation was destroyed by the British, but his family escaped to the north. George Walton was wounded and captured. After release, he served as governor and chief justice of Georgia and as a United States senator. Thomas Hayward Jr. served in the army and was taken prisoner. British raided his plantation while he was in prison and burned his buildings. His wife became ill and died before he was released. Arthur Middleton was captured and imprisoned after the British ravaged his plantation. Later, he served in the Congress. In 1788, he contracted a fever and died at the age of 44. William Hooper of North Carolina was hunted by the British. He fled, and they burned his home and lands. Hooper served in the North Carolina legislature, and in 1770, he died at the age of 48. That should be 1790. The numbers are reversed here. In 1790, he died at the age of 48. Thomas Nelson Jr. served as governor of Virginia and distributed large sums of his money to the families of his soldiers. At the Battle of Yorktown, he led 3,000 Virginia militia against the British. Although the British took refuge in homes belonging to Virginians, Nelson's troops shelled them anyway. During the engagement, Nelson turned one cannon on his own home and lit the fuse, killing the two British officers inside. After the Revolution, his health declined and he died in 1789. How many of you would do the same? At the time of the signing, John Hancock, one of the wealthiest men in the 13 colonies, was one of two colonial leaders up to that time who were wanted for hanging. He too pledged all that he had for independence and signed his name so boldly that even today a signature is referred to as a John Hancock. He did it as a flaunt to the king, but the king had sentenced him to death upon capture. One another on the British wanted list was courageous Samuel Adams, one of the few representatives of tall, modest means. He proudly affixed his name and left to her with his entire life in service. Sacrifices, services of these men and their families are typical, ladies and gentlemen, of the price which an entire generation of brave Americans were willing to pay for freedom. Payne, Thornton, Whitmer, and Bartlett gave their lives for this motion. They all risked their lives and fortunes by signing the document which would become the philosophical foundation. The inspired document, ladies and gentlemen, had come from the pen of Thomas Jefferson. Other members of the committee had played a part in the final wording, but according to Richard Stockton, it was John Adams, to whom the country is most indebted for the great measure of independency. For it was Adams, he noted, who sustained the debate, and by force of his reason alone demonstrated not only the justice, but the expediency of the measure. When the spirits of some might have wavered, Adams' impassioned appeal had given them an extra measure of courage for the vote to adopt the Declaration of Independence. But the story does not end here. Both Jefferson, the author of the Declaration, and Adams, its leading advocate, were unable to attend the 1787 Constitutional Convention because they were representing America abroad. Both, however, served as President of the United States. Both headed up the first political parties in the new republic. Jefferson becoming the leader of the Republicans. Did you hear that? Jefferson becoming the leader of the Republicans, and Adams assuming command of the Federalists. All this Clintonista rhetoric about Jeffersonian Democrats is absolute 100% total bullshit. And that's the label on the can that you should put it in. All of this democratic parroting of the word Jeffersonian Democrat or the Jeffersonian Democratic Party is a lie, like almost everything else that they parrot, for they are chronic liars. Jefferson was the leader of the Republican Party. Adams was the leader of the Federalists. In retirement, although these two men had not shared the same beliefs on some issues, they maintained a deep and abiding friendship through voluminous correspondence, which you should all obtain and read if you care one iota about your future. On the 50th anniversary of American independence, July 4th, 1826, John Adams died.
final words were, and I quote,
"Thomas Jefferson remains," end quote.
You see, he was not aware that before noon, on that very same day, Thomas Jefferson, too,
had passed away.
Exactly 50 years after that glorious day, when by their very courageous actions, the miracle that we know as America had begun. Many, many things have happened between then and now. But one of the greatest things that has happened is that the American people have forgotten the men who brought this country into being, the ideals upon which they based, the great gifts that they handed down to you, their posterity, and the principles to which they held true, to which they were willing to give everything that they owned and held dear to bring into being. How is it that we are so eager to give these things away? You see, it takes an enlightened, committed people who understand the principles of our Constitution to maintain the status of liberty and freedom. Mark my words, all of you listening around the world, if America falls, so go you. The most effective means of preserving liberty is to understand it. You see, although all men are born free, slavery has been a bitter lot of the human race. Ignorant, they have been cheated. Asleep, or been surprised. Divided, the yoke has been forced upon them. But what is the lesson? The people ought to be enlightened, to be awakened, to be united, that after establishing a government, they should watch over it. It is universally admitted that a well-instructed people alone can be permanently free. James Madison said that. He didn't know anything about today, but he understood very well human nature. Thomas Jefferson said, "We must not let our rulers load us with perpetual debt. We must make our election between economy and liberty our profusion and servitude." William Blackstone said, "Man must necessarily be subject to the laws of his creator. This will of his maker is called the law of nature. This law of nature is, of course, superior to any other. No human laws are of any validity if contrary to this, and such of them as are valid derive all their force from this original." America's Constitution is the means by which knowledgeable and free people, capable of self-government, if they are, can bind and control their elected representatives in government. In order to remain free, the founders said, the people themselves must clearly understand the ideas and principles upon which their constitutional government is based. Through such understanding, they will be able to prevent those in power from eroding their constitutional protections. See, our founders established schools and seminaries for the distinct purpose of instilling in youth the lessons of history, the ideals of liberty. And in their day, they were successful. Tocqueville, eminent French jurist, traveled America, and in his 1830s work entitled Democracy in America, wrote, "Every citizen is taught the doctrines and the evidences of his religion, the history of his country,
and the leading features of its constitution. It is extremely rare to find a man imperfectly acquainted with all these things, and a person wholly ignorant of them is a sort of phenomenon. Today, ladies and gentlemen, a person who understands and knows these things is the rarity. While he was on the front chair, he noted that no sort of comparison can be drawn between the pioneer and the dwelling that shelters him. He wears the dress and speaks the language of the saints. He is acquainted with the past, curious about the future, and ready for argument about the present. I do not think that so much intellectual activity exists in the most enlightened and populous districts of France. And he continued. He said, it cannot be doubted that in the United States the instruction of the people powerfully contributes to the support of the Democratic Republic, and such must always be the case, where the instruction which enlightens the understanding is not separated from the moral education. We cannot say that tonight. And thus our clear understanding of the failure of previous civilizations to achieve and sustain freedom for individuals, our forefathers discovered some timeless truths about human nature, and that was their forte. They knew and understood human nature probably better than anyone who has ever lived. The struggle for individual liberty, the human tendency toward abuse of power, and the means for curbing that tendency through constitutional self-government. Jefferson's bill for the more general diffusion of knowledge for Virginia declared, and I quote, "Experience hath shown that even under the best forms of government, those entrusted with power have in time, and by slow operations, perverted it into tyranny. And it is believed that the most effectual means of preventing this would be to illuminate the minds of the people, to give them knowledge of those facts which history exhibited. History, by apprising them of the past, will enable them to judge of the future. It will qualify them as judges of the actions and designs of men. It will enable them to know ambition under every disguise it may assume, and knowing it, to defeat its views." End quote. See, education was not perceived by the founders to be a mere process for teaching basic skills. It was much, much more. Education included the very process by which the people of America would understand and be able to preserve their liberty and secure their creator-endowed rights. And this is not taught anymore. That is why the state has seized control of the schools, so that it will not, cannot be taught. And any teacher who begins to teach these things will not long be a teacher today. Understanding the nature and origin of our rights and the means of preserving them, the people would be capable of self-government, for they would recognize any threats to liberty and nip the hopes of arbitrary power in the bud, said John Adams. Little did he know the apathy, ignorance, and yes, stupidity of the modern American. If he did, he may not have risked everything. Basic idea of America's constitution was a small federal government, strong local and state governments, and a well-armed people to make sure that it stayed that way. A militia made up of the whole of the people, so that tyranny could never take root in America. And that's why those who would have a socialist, one-world totalitarian government are so afraid of the militia, and that's why they must demonize these good, patriotic Americans who, like our founding fathers, are willing to risk all.
Including the ridicule of those who haven't the slightest idea of what it's all about. You see, the basic idea is to get government as close to the people as possible. The more remote it is from the people, the more dangerous it becomes.
In the words of Thomas Jefferson, ladies and gentlemen,
the true theory of our Constitution is surely the wisest and best.
When all government shall be drawn to Washington
as the center of all power, it will render powerless the checks provided of one government on another and will become as oppressive as the government from which we separated. What has destroyed the liberty and the rights of man in every government which has ever existed under the sun, the generalizing and concentrating all cares and powers into one body. The way to have good and safe government is not to trust it all to one, but to divide it among the many. For it is by dividing and separating these republics from the great national one down that all will be done for the best. James Madison's possible necessity to reserve all possible power in the states and the people, saying, and I quote, "The powers delegated from the Constitution to the federal government are few and determined. Those which are to remain in the state governments are numerous and indefinite, and the rest shall remain with the people." Amendment 10. The powers not delegated to the United States by the Constitution, nor prohibited by it to the states, are reserved to the states respectively or to the people. What in the world has happened? See, the genius of America's Constitution was its separation of powers. America's founders had declared themselves free
for tyrannical government.
They were determined for such time would never be repeated in this land. Their new charter, the government, the Constitution, very carefully defined the powers delegated to government, outlined them clearly, and forbade any more. Our powers were determined to bind down the administrators of the federal government with constitutional chains so that abuse of power in any of its branches would be prevented. You see, the revolutionary idea of separation of powers, although unpopular at first, became a means by which this was to be accomplished. John Adams, in a letter to Dr. Benjamin Rush, stated, quote, "I called you to witness that I was the first member of Congress in venture to come out in public as I did in January 1776 in my thoughts on government in favor of a government with three branches and an independent judiciary." End quote. By the time the Constitution was adopted, the idea was supported by all of the members of the convention. James Madison, the father of the Constitution, devoted five Federalist Papers, numbers 47 through 51, to an explanation of how the executive, legislative, and judicial branches were to be wholly independent of each other, yet bound together through an intricate system of checks and balances. Madison believed that keeping the three branches separate was fundamental to the preservation of liberty. Yeah. The accumulation of all powers, legislative, executive, and judiciary, in the same hands, whether of one, a few, or many, may justly be pronounced the very definition of tyranny. George Washington, in his farewell address, reminded Americans of the need to preserve the founders' system. He spoke of the love of power and proneness to abuse it
which predominates in the human heart, and warned of the necessity of reciprocal checks of political power by dividing and distributing it into different depositories and constituting each the guardian against invasions by the others. Of such checks and balances, through the separation of powers, he concluded, to preserve them must be as necessary as to constitute them. The system of subversion of the Constitution for the United States of America, beginning as early as the Civil War, taking its main form in 1913 with the, what we call the Federal Reserve Act, and then the total subversion by granting the war powers to the President on March the 9th, 1935. And then, by the misinterpretation of Article 6 of the Constitution for the United States of America, and this misinterpretation states that by signing and ratifying a treaty, it supersedes the supreme law of the land, which is the Constitution. Our forefathers made it clear that nothing could supersede the law of the land, the Constitution, but that treaties must be in alignment with it. But by all of this, the adoption of the United Nations Treaty and the passage of the United Nations Participation Act and many, many, many more, the balance of power has been rendered asunder. All of the powers of the government are in one hand, and William Clinton, that is how dare I say that we live in tyranny in the freest country in the world. But while the rest of the world is bound by three chains, it makes no difference whether we are bound by one or two. We are still the freest country in the world, and we are still living under tyranny, and we are just a stone's throw from the third chain. That is how dare I, and I will continue to dare. And if need be, I will give my life for my country. I understand the difference now. I understand full well that I was a fool, thinking that I was serving my country when I was sent to Vietnam to further the interest of tyranny, and that now I am called a terrorist for standing up on the soil that my fathers and my forefathers and our founding fathers fought and died to protect. As a patriot, more lives Bill Clinton won't lose. Sony Democrats, indeed. It is amazing that Americans have lost the ability to use their brains. Good night. God bless each and every single one of you.